sector is the largest provider of rural livelihoods in India. Yet, access to long-term credit from formal institutional lenders is often a hurdle. Hello and welcome. I'm Pooja Sarkar from Forbes India, and I will be moderating this session on policies to increase long-term credit access for the farm sector from institutional lenders. And we have a very distinguished and diverse panel to offer their insights. And let me introduce them to you. First and foremost, we have with us Mr. Ramacharyolu, who has more than 2.5 decades of experience in leading various verticals at State Bank of India. He's currently the GM of NBFC Alliances at SBI, where he's responsible for forging alliances with NBFCs for on-lending, co-lending, and portfolio purchase, and developing this segment for the bank. Welcome, sir.
Thank you.
Next, we have Dr. Sameer Agarwal from India's largest private sector bank, HDFC, where he is the head of Pharma, Supply Chain Financing, and Product Management of Rural Banking Group. Dr. Sameer, who has nearly 2 decades of experience in working across verticals in retail and wholesale banking, is also a member of IBA's Standing Panel of Reserve Bank of India on Agri-Finance. Welcome. And moving on from banks, we have Mr. Prabhat Chaturvedi, Chief Executive Officer at Netafim Agricultural Financing Agency, that's NAFA. Under his leadership at NAFA, it is rapidly expanding to become a formidable NBFC offering customized financial solutions for the entire value chain of smart irrigation systems in India. And we have another person from the NBFC space, Mr. Sachinder Nath. He's the Executive Chairman and Managing Director at Ugrow Capital. He has been a financial services professional for over 26 years before he turned entrepreneur and founded Ugrow Capital Limited in 2018 by taking control of listed NBFC Chokhani Securities. Ugrow started its journey raising 950 crores as institutional capital. And if I'm not wrong, it is one of the largest fundraisers. And AgriTech, which is at the heart of this conversation, and we have someone representing the Indian agrotech economy, is Mr. Mayank Dhanuka, who is the co-founder of Origo Commodities, who started his venture over a decade back. From procurement, warehousing, digital e-auction to financing, Origo now takes care of the entire agri supply chain. Thank you everyone for joining in and taking time today. And let me just start right away by asking Mr. Charyalu, what are the biggest challenges in raising this long-term finance in the farming space?
Okay, thanks for the meeting. It's quite interesting. And before I answer your question, just to give you the perspective, let me quote 2 facts. One thing is that farm equipment market itself is expected to be something between 900 to 1,000 billion rupees by 2024. So depending on whose report we are reading, it's somewhere here and there, and then the growth is around 10 to 11%. And that is one point. Second point is that, interestingly, in the year 2000, the share of long-term and short-term financing in agriculture was equal. But now by the time we reach 2019, where the latest numbers are available, it has become 75 is short-term and 25 is long-term. So we are definitely seeing a declining trend in the long-term financing to agriculture by the farmer lenders, definitely, because these numbers are from the Reserve Bank of India report. So definitely there is something amiss here. On one hand, we are seeing a requirement for mechanization going up because of migration, because people want to cut down cost, and already the margin of agricultural activity is under stress. So people do want to improve their margin, so they want to cut costs. But at the same time, the investment is going down as a proportion to total credit. So briefly, we can say this is a high level picture. I think the issues here is that foremost fragmentation of agricultural holdings, and then there is no institutional frameworks to bring them back together. some kind of cooperative or any such kind of institutional aggregation. That is one issue, because with a very small holding, it is, there is no big incentive for mechanization. And then we have institutional access also for small and marginal farmers. It becomes expensive for them to reach out to an institution. And somehow, from the institution side, there has been some level of aversion towards lending into long-term finance in agriculture because of NPL levels. And once again, looking towards the farmer side, there are issues like high turnaround time from institutions and the cost of reaching out to the institutions, and then cost of the time and resources involved going so many times. This is one aspect. And once again, from our perspective, if you see lack of credit history and then high operational cost and issue of collateral cover, these are some of the issues, these are some of the challenges. And once again, the environment of recovery or repayment is also being vitiated by some of the external factors. So I don't want to name them, but then we know debt recovery and those issues also have impacts there. I think, and one more thing is that lack of digitization of land records, because this also creates some hurdle in taking quick decisions or automating these processes. I think these are all things which come to my mind. And other panelists, please chip in if you have something more. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Would anybody like to add anything, or should I just get to the second question?
Yeah, so I would want to, first of all, I would like to thank Sankal for giving me this opportunity to come and, share some of the views. As far as this particular question is concerned, I tell you what, it's been, quite some time, been 20 years that, with SDFC Bank, IDFC Bank, PNB, we have been doing farmer financing. And farmer financing is, it's very nice topic to talk about, right? And it's been talked everywhere. But, it's very simple. It is not that complicated a subject or in a complicated an issue. And since we have been working with the farmers closely for so many years, let me tell you, my experience is it's very, very simple. It's not at all complex. When you talk about, and I'll come to your question also. Basically, what is there? Why it is the simplest product? There is a land per acre. There is a funding which is defined by the government. There is a KCC circular, Kisan Credit Card, which defines how to go about it. And then you have to go to a farmer, look at the land, look at the crop, and then put up an application form and then give a loan, which is more or less perpetual as far as that limit is concerned. Problem comes in, how many farmers we would want to fund and which kind of a farmer we would want to fund. Now, I have a target. If it is achieved, probably I would not go further, right? And I will go one by one. Stage one, stage two, stage three. Stage one would be large farmers, stage two would be small farmer, and stage three would be marginal farmer, and stage four would be farmer who has no land but who is a tenant and sharecropper. So we are in a stage two as far as almost all the banks are concerned. We have not moved to the stage three or partially moved to the stage three, and probably this is the time that because one or two are already saturated, and even if they are not saturated, they will be saturated soon. And your targets year on year will continue to be there. And I'm typically talking from the point of view of the bank, Scheduled Commercial Bank being regulated by Reserve Bank of India. Now question is, why institutional credit? No, investment credit, how it's a crop loan, agri loan has two components. One is crop loan, another one is investment credit. Now crop loan, between last 10 years, if you look at the percentage of crop loan in the term loan, earlier it was almost, 51 and 49. CC was like around 51% and term loan was around, which is a long-term investment credit, was 49%. It has come down to 75 to 25. Now 75 is a working capital and 25 is a term loan. Now why it is so? And here your question, Pooja, is specifically about that term loan component and why it is coming down, and that's going to be an investment credit and that's going to be upgradation of the agriculture way. And primarily, there is no product for any farmer in this country, amongst all the you know NBFCs, banking institution, public sector, private sector, RRBs, which gives them a 6 monthly or annual repayment pattern for any other loan but crop. Agar ke ek farmer ko apna education loan lena hai, he will have to pay monthly. If he has to take a scooter loan, he will have to pay monthly. If he has to take a housing loan, he will have to pay monthly. If he has to go for you know anything, he has to pay monthly. So he will not take, he will not get, because his cash flows are different. So what he does it from the your crop loan CC limit. So he uses this particular limit for the for all these purposes. So he always asks for a higher limit, which goes for non-agri purposes. And his ability to pay you is 100. So under 100, you have given him 80 rupees, which is CC. And how, half of it is consumed for non-agri purpose. So at the end of the day, while you know for a bank, for an institution, a PSL target to the extent of X amount is met, but it is, actually it is not helping farmer for long-term investment credit. Government is also, you know, the policies where the support system which is provided to the farmer is in and around crop loans, because crop loan component was more like interest subvention. It is not for the term loan component, it is for the CC component, right? Crop insurance, it is for the CC component, not for the term loan component. And if you look at, you know, overall other debt waivers which are being announced by the respective state and the central governments, they are for the crop loan, not for the term loan. So you tell me why in the whole world somebody would fund him for the term loan? First of all, the customer is not ready because he requires some other, his requirements are not met through the term loans. They are end use specific. So here we need to actually look at, you know, look at multiple ways, you know, and somewhere we need some support from the regulator also. Ki we should be able to give non-agri purpose loan for the farmers as per their cash flows. It is not that, you know, banks are not providing, they are not able to provide. So this one change, which I think would give a lot of space to this particular area. Second thing, government should give the subvention to the investment credit also as along with CC. Thirdly, insurance should be provided for the term loans also. Fourth, I think for now, this is from the typically from the point of view of the offerings. Now, second comes is like, you know, which kind of a farmers. So I think they are below, you know, after a particular ticket size, like 80% of a small and marginal farmer contributes 20% of the agri economy, right? Now, if we look at it as a from the welfare point of view, it's one way of looking at it. If we are looking at it from a commercial point of view, it's a different way of looking at it. Having said that, let's bring both of them together. I think government, the total outlay of, you know, for the support to this particular sector is around 4 lakh crore a year, which includes everything. I mean, including subsidies, subventions, your waivers, you know, other support through PM Kisan and all that, TBT transfers. Why can't we create another, you know, specific area and look at, you know, what is the credit loss per year for a small and marginal farmer in the banking industry? And if we come out like we have come out for the MSME, SME as a CGA credit guarantee scheme for term loans to certain extent, I'm sure that, you know, this whole thing will be revolutionized, will be changed. So these are the limited points which I wanted to make. We can keep on, you know, I can keep on, you know, talking for another half an hour, but, you know, there are many things which we can do. But if we do these things, you know, precisely, I'll tell you, this will change.
True.
Yeah, I'll add only three specific points, sorry, to this discussion, what Mr. Mm-hmm. Charulu said and Samir also hinted at. Three specific things. One, we are talking about 50-50 and 75-25. If you see the trend, it is consistently declining. Like a crocodile jaw, the crop loan is going up and the term loan is going down, and it will remain so. As a result, the gross capital formation also, which was around 18% around 2011, has come down to less than 4%, I think, now. So capital formation is not happening. We are talking about farm mechanization. We are talking about ag-techs revolutionizing the agriculture. But the farmers are not getting money for buying these machines or digitizing or mechanizing their agriculture. And third specific point is repayment frequency probably is not the major reason. The crop loans are perpetual in nature, and they have the subsidy support and all the insurance, crop insurance support also. You are not basically required to repay this. You basically keep servicing interest and the principal remains with you. Maybe some other bank takes over that limit at some point, and you get enhanced limit. And maybe some other bank then tries to win you and gives you higher limit. So you have a perpetual credit. You keep serving the interest. You're not required to repay. Whereas term loans, you are required to repay, whether it is monthly installments or 6 monthly or annual, that can be structured. But this money has to go out and repay. That is the hindrance. Probably that's why the adoption amongst farmer is more for crop loans. And banks are also offering crop loans more than the equipment loans.
Okay, I'll go to Mr. Nath now. I mean, I just wanted to understand from your end, you know, how technological intervention and upgradation of existing technology by financial institutions can actually help farmers and other agri stakeholders that who can access long-term finance. And do you see there is a way, because you've been hearing that, you know, the floor is just open with the discussion that it is going down, it may go down. Do you see a reason where it'll pick up?
Yeah, no, thanks, Pooja. Thanks, Ankal, for inviting me. I'm no expert when it comes to agriculture and farming loans. Bugro's aspiration is to build a large SME financing business. Some component of our SME financing business, which is food and food process sector, have a commercial linkage to the farm sector as well. I think before I come to the level of digitization, let me say this, right? One of the biggest problems with the farm sector is fragmentation and commercial linkages with the sector. You know, the average land holding in India is just 1 hectare, and all of the, you know, farm produce is controlled through APMC. We were hoping that the, you know, new policy initiative would to some extent de-bottleneck, but given the political noise around it, I don't think so that's going to see light of the day. One of the big challenge is ability for especially the outside bank lender or new generation lender, and I so, you know, some of them are already here. One of the problem is of how do you assess the ability to pay? Because majority of the lending today or the credit creation today is moving away from a borrower's entity level, you know, cash flow or individual cash flow to a transaction-based cash flow. Till the time you don't have digital procurement, digital marketplace, and a track record which get created for farmers for their produce to be sold, and their ability to repay it at a high frequency, the credit to the farm sector, you know, is very difficult to come in the full force. And that has been one challenge. Second, your question with respect to digitization. So till the time we don't like, you know, we see this in happening in SME as a sector. Look at this, roughly around 2 million plus small businesses are now linked to different kind of marketplaces. And as soon as that has happened, most of those small businesses, the availability as credit is now becoming a reality. Because lenders can now see the frequency of transaction data, how much of good and services, which goods basically one is selling, and how much time it takes to get that goods sold and cash flow, which comes to a marketplace, then comes back to the lender. So once we'll see the procurement and the interlinkages in the entire value chain start happening digitally, multiple new generation lenders' ability to lend against that flow is far easier, because the one of the constraining factor is physical footprint, which is required to lend to the farmers. Because India is such a vast country, so except large banks who have deep rural footprint and who has to do their assessment physically of the farmer, and if it's a crop loan, which is more perpetual by nature. For new generation technology-led lending institution is very difficult to enter into that sector. So I think so once you'll gradually, I think so there is a policy reform which has to happen, right? Given that it's a state versus, and there is cartel and lobby around, APMCs and traders and all of that. But once gradually that de-bottlenecks and more digital platform around procurement, which, connect the large buyers, which is the corporate sector, to a small farmer, and this digital procurement would give a transaction flow, which the lending and capital creation can start happening. So I think so we are at a very early stage of some of that is happening. People like Origa and others are doing it. But as it just continue to increase, you will see a new generation of, new lines of credit flow, which will start happening. I don't think so there is money which is not available. I think it's about how do you deliver that money in hand of the farmer while protecting the interest of the balance sheet providers. Is the key experimentation which will happen over next decade or so.
True, agree. Mayank, I'll take it to you. I know you've been waiting for some time now. What are the policy gaps and specific interventions from the government that are required for accessing long-term financing by various players in the food supply value chain? Because you are someone who's apart from, you know, beginning to end, you see the whole cycle. What is your view?
So look, I'm not qualified to address what specific policy changes are required, but I'll tell you what I see as the main challenge or challenges and what, in our opinion, can can address those. So I think most of it has been addressed by various panelists, but it all boils down to two things. One is the distribution of capital, right, to those who need it. And secondly, and even more importantly, because that drives the first in many ways, is our ability to recover that money. And I think it is the lack of ability to recover, which has essentially been a huge roadblock in the distribution of capital to the eventual users. So, you know, I know we talk about the farmer a lot, but it's getting it right down to the farmer level is an incredibly challenging task. As Mr. Nath said, you know, the average landholding in India is about a hectare, right? That's nothing, right? The average farm size in most developed economies is about 10,000 acres. So, you know, and which is operated by say 5 to 10 people. Here we've got 10 people working on every hectare. So it's, you know, socialism is not the way to go. I think what we need to do is we need to have some long-term solutions in place, which essentially change things over time. So I'll try to address two or three of them relatively quickly. We talked about digitization of land records. That's actually an incredibly important thing to do, because the basis of, I mean, there are a lot of bankers on this panel, and I'm sure they'll all agree that the basis of any lending has to be an underlying record of ownership of the collateral, which is easily provable. And I mean, I remember reading this book a long time ago, about 15, 20 years ago, by this Peruvian economist called Hernando de Soto, the book called Mystery of Capital. He talks about how most of the Western economies were able to very early in their lives, they were able to create digitization or clear demarcation or holding of land records. So that is very clear who holds what. And they were able to use that as an underlying instrument and generate more capital on top of that, right? And that is something that, you know, we've been, as a country, we've really been challenged to do that. I mean, if you go back 20, 30 years, or even today, you see a lot of disputes on land records. So that's absolutely key. The second thing that, I want to address is we've talked about welfare versus a commercial view. I don't think welfare is the way to go. I don't think it ever is. I mean, look at the world today. Look at the world 70, 80 years ago, right? From the mid 20th century till today, you find that most of the countries which sort of went the communist way were really very capitalistic in nature in terms of how their leaders acted, right? But and the welfare never really reached down to the last level. And in the long term, that's just not the way to go if you want the country as a whole to develop. So the view in that sense has to be a free market view. It has to be a commercial view. But there have to be government policies which eventually support that commercial view, right? The money has to get into the hands of people, but there has to be recovery. And I think that's where, you really have to think of the short-term view versus the long-term view. The short-term view is always, let's get money in the hands of the people that need it, right? But that view can often be flawed because that eventually leads to poor recovery, which eventually leads to banks backing off from this kind of an initiative, and it's never repeated. It goes into, you know, it goes on ice for another 5 or 10 years. The long-term view is that you have to create efficiency in the entire supply chain, right? So the supply chain, which is from inputs all the way to consumption, right? If you're able to create efficiency in terms of distribution of capital, in terms of availability of capital to start with, I think that's when you really start addressing the problem. This is not going to be a quick fix. This is not going to be a band-aid of sorts. And this is going to take a long, long time. And frankly, that's where somebody like us comes in and plays a role, because I think Mr. Nath again talked about creating a marketplace for price discovery. That's what we are doing. That's what some of our peers are doing. What that means is that the farmer at least knows. I mean, the farmers are pretty smart. They know what price they produce, but they're often forced to sell it to somebody who gives them a lot less money than they deserve. And that's, again, a problem you can't address on day one. But if you put mechanisms in place where price discovery becomes more transparent, there is more money flowing into supply chain, right? It may not necessarily be to farmers today, but eventually it'll get to them. It may not be today, it may be 2 years from now, it may be 5 years from now. But so long as you can do these two things, I think that's going to lead to a lot of long-term good. I don't know if that's what you were asking, Pooja, but I hope it addresses your question.
Yes, it does. But I'm just going to move towards the banking panel right now. Mr. Charyalu, let me just first ask you, we've seen the pandemic last year and the impact are still there. In these times, how challenging was it to lend? And second, what are the ways to reduce transaction cost for microloan to farmers, which would ultimately benefit the farm sector borrowers? I'll take it to you, and then I would request Mr. Dr. Agarwal to add to it.
Thanks. Now, the first stage of pandemic did not really impact the rural or villages in a very big way. That's a known fact. So we were not impacted in such a big fashion. And so much so, I think last year, the growth, at least our bank in the agricultural short-term lending was quite okay. This year, yes, we have a challenge that rural sector is also impacted, but the monsoon is just here. It is just retreating now. So agricultural activity is picking up except for areas where floods and those impacts have come. But prima facie, as all speakers have said, the short-term lending or crop loans are not a big issue now. In fact, in some states where digitization and access to digital land records have been provided, we have been able to reduce transaction costs by bringing in mechanization and automating the loan processing. So much so in some of the states where digital land records are made accessible to banks, the short-term borrowers, that is crop loan borrowers, are able to renew their loans by using our app. And then that way the transaction cost has gone down to a great extent. But really onboarding per se, then for the new customers, like our friend said earlier, we have just completed the stage one and stage two, large farmers and then small and medium farmers. And then if we want to really go to very small and then sharecroppers or tenant farmers, there the transaction values will be much less, and with these existing processes, they will not be viable for the banking industry. We need to, in a big way, automate the processes by accessing digital land records and identifying people in a digital fashion, and also utilize the services of banking correspondents or non-banking financial companies or business associates or any other kind of associates in this process who can work as a layer between the bank and the ultimate borrower, whom we can pay a service fee which will be less than the traditional transaction cost of the bank. I think that is the way forward, and the way the costs are going up, particularly the human resource cost is going up in the entire banking industry. Servicing a large number of such small borrowers in the existing setup of rural and semi-urban branches for the banking industry will be unviable. So obviously, the way forward is to use the NBFCs, banking correspondents, and technologies, our fintech companies, and associating with them and listening with them, coordinating with them.
Thank you. Dr. Agarwal, if you can just take it from there.
Yeah, sure, Pooja. I think, your question was, let me just repeat your question. Your question was basically, how pandemic has impacted the crop lending or farmer lending last year and prior to that, and secondly how we can bring in a cost efficiency in reaching out to the small and marginal farmer or the farmer as a whole, right? So yeah, the first year of this thing, pandemic was, and especially first quarter, because it is immediately after February, April, May, June, there was a problem in terms of overall consumption of the credit at the farm level for three reasons. Not because it it was not required, because there was no movement even for a relationship manager or branch manager, even for the customers to reach out to the bank or RM. Or a branch manager to reach out to the farmer, to his farm and everything, and do an assessment was next to impossible because there were restrictions on the movement. That is point number one. And hence, there was a lack of credit offtake at the bank's level. The point number two, there was also interstate movement issues, and hence harvest was not done by the farmers because they could not supply their goods to other states. And since the harvest was not done, so there was no requirement of the credit at that point in time for the production of the crop. They all had delayed their harvest for some. Thirdly, realization of the prices did not happen for first 3 months because, there was no procurement which was done by the government, even by the local traders, because there is interstate procurement also which happens in the mandis. So these are the reasons why there was no specific credit offtake at that point in time. However, government has come out with a policy, good policy at that point in time, which was emergency credit line, which you can give as an over top of the line kind of enhancement to your existing customers, which was like saving grace for almost all the banks, and we could manage to leverage our existing customers. I don't know really, I'm not very sure about the new customers at that point in time. This year when pandemic came, this time there was no restriction on the movement, barring 10-15 days. And of course, crop and season has been fantastic since last 2 years, so there is a bumper offtake of this. I'm still keeping my fingers crossed. I don't think that there is barring Gujarat, cyclone and all that, there is by far, India has been quite good with the monsoon and the climatic interventions which God once in a while does. So that was fine. Now let's come to the second point. How we can do the cost cutting in this particular segment. We should understand one thing. Again, I'm saying, small and marginal farmers are 80% number out of 14 crore total units. When I say units, means agri land piece. Hamare yahan 14 crore agri land ke khet hain. Usme se 12 crore small and marginal farmer ke paas hain. Lekin they contribute to 20% of the agriculture output. Financing is directly proportional to the agriculture output, right? So for me, even if I try and lend to this particular segment, I will lend only up to the extent of 20% of whatever I would want to do, right? Now, for that 20%, my cost of acquisition should be, as rightly said by other panelists, including Mr. Rama and, Mr. Nath also has referred to this thing. I should reach out to them in a way whereby, my touch base, physical brick and mortar touch base or, hard and, blood and flesh touch base should be minimal so that my cost would be limited. Now, what are the four things which a bank would do or a financial institution would do? I'm typically talking from the point of view of bank. मुझे क्या देखना रहता है एज राइटली सेड बाय मयंक एबिलिटी टू रिपे इज वन पार्ट बट हाउ टू असेस इट बिकॉज खेत है खेत पे फसल बोई है वो कैसी निकलेगी 4 महीने बाद या 6 महीने बाद ये तो भगवान जानता है राइट इट्स नॉट अ अप एंड रन बिजनेस वेयर आई कैन सी द बैलेंस शीट एंड सी द 3 years ऑफ प्रॉफिटेबिलिटी टुमारो आई रियली डोंट नो वेदर ही हैव अ क्रॉप और ही हैव एन आउटपुट और नॉट वाइल आई कैन ऑलवेज And there is no GST, so I cannot see the finances also. And every crop has 14,000 different varieties in terms of output. So there is a different valuation for that. So I need to see four things. मेरे को क्या देखना है उसके appraisal में? उसके पास ज़मीन है, ज़मीन की खेती करता है, उसका social status क्या है? Which I want to bring in other than financial parameters. And they are more important for small and marginal farmers. It's not only about his repayment capacity because it is very difficult to assess. I need to bring in social parameters. उसकी सोशल स्टैंडिंग क्या है उस गांव में उसकी उसके लिए कोई ओपिनियन मेकर है या नहीं है दूसरा बात वो कितने साल से वहां पर खेती कर रहा है तीसरा उसके उस पर्टिकुलर टाइम पे वेदर का प्रोजेक्शंस क्या है सो आई नीड सैटेलाइट इमेजरीज आई नीड स्काईमेट काइंड ऑफ अ थिंग व्हिच वुड गिव मी दैट व्हाट इज द इरिगेशन लेवल इन दैट पर्टिकुलर एरिया Then overall, you know, every month I should be able to monitor that, you know, how the top is moving, you know, what is going to be a probable output. And then, you know, as fantastically said by everyone, that, you know, the digitization of records is happening. It is happening, but it is still a work in process. It should be linked to the overlapping of data, satellite imagery data, crop loan, along with, you know, other social indicator data should be overlapped with the his land records. And those land records should be able to forefront these information to the bank. And bank should be able to create charge and, you know, release the charge through the system directly. And of course, you know, if somewhere somebody would be able to, you know, put up another database, which is his credit history, even if it is not there, mortgage of the land or, you know, charge on the land would give us a good idea as in, you know, how this thing is moved. I think this whole thing can be by click of button and we can do it in a day's time. Ek din mein hum loan sanction karke disburse kar sakte hain. Usme kuch aisa lamba choda kaam nahi hai. In fact, for our existing customer, we do it. All enhancements, we do it digitally. In fact, it's couple of our loans are like 10-minute loans. If somebody comes to me and asks for an enhancement, I can give him 10 minutes. That's what we call KGC Turand. We can do it for new customers also. If I have his satellite imagery data in terms of his crop, and of course, you know, his KYC data through, you know, government UCIC, and thirdly, mortgage through the land records of the land or charges on the land. Ki kisne hataya hai, kisi aur bank ka to nahi lagaya, koi charge society ka to nahi chadaya. All those things, if I can, you know, fix up in the system, ho raha hai, kaafi had tak ho gaya hai. But abhi tak ek apas mein, all these things are being done, you know, in a isolation. If they all, you know, all these digitalization, if they put it on one single consolidated window, like Bhumi in Karnataka, Jharbhumi in Jharkhand, or, you know, there are many names which are state-wise, if they can just bring it there, and I think we are pretty near to it. I'm sure it's a matter of few hours, not even a day. And that's the only way that you can reach out to these things. And of course, you know, there are multiple ways of funding. This is typically farmer and crop loan. Then they are supply chain financing. They are, you know, FPOs. They are cooperatives. There are multiple ways of funding to a large section of the farmer. But I'm typically talking about, you know, how to reach out to individual farmer. If Samir Agarwal is a farmer, he's small and marginal, how to reach out to him. And that's a larger segment, and that's a segment which banks generally prefer. Right? Yeah. So
That's understandable. Basically, a CIBIL for farming ecosystem is what we are talking about.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Something like that.
I will go to Mr. Chaturvedi, you know, specifically on equipment financing, because that is something I thought we should bring in at this point in time. What are the challenges that you see are being faced by the farmers to access equipment financing? And also, what are the policy interventions that are required to ensure incentives for research and development that is required for equipment manufacturers?
Thanks, Pooja. And before I respond to that, I want to add to the discussion that was happening. And yes. Unfortunately, we don't talk about it, the initiatives that government is taking. And as Samir rightly said, if you see this as a jigsaw puzzles, we already have pieces in place. You already have Aadhaar for almost every citizen. You already have their bank account linked to it. You already have their mobile number linked to that Aadhaar ID. You have their land record with government. It's all there. And the requirement that he rightly said to bring it under one ecosystem or one platform is also happening. Government announced it in July, I think, Unified Farmer Services Interface, UFSI, which unfortunately in our media is not much talked about, but the foreign media is going gaga. Fortune is calling it a $1 trillion fintech opportunity. My directors in Israel are telling me that look at this closely, what is happening and who are the big players participating and how can we collaborate with them. This digitization of agriculture or all the components linked to it is happening already. It has started. Some players like CropIn, SkyMate are doing their bit. I think the government has to collate it all together. Some maybe buy, some build on their own and offer it conveniently. And it's not an opportunity only for BFSI. It can be an opportunity for the post-harvest players, for the commodity players, for the input players, for the soil health players, for the entire ecosystem around agriculture. That is already happening. It has started. It's not easy. It will take some time. But when that happens, which I think Mr. Nath and Mr. Mayank also talked about it, then you have the transactional routing. You already know if the farmer is selling on this platform, whether it is a private platform or a public platform or to FCI, if we know who is selling, we have his Aadhaar, we have his land record linked to it. The classic problem that happens, that one may be a middleman, kacha adatiya or a pakka adatiya, he collates all the produce. The farmer is not getting the right ratio out of the price that government is paying. It's mostly going to the middleman. That will be solved because you are buying directly from farmers, you are paying directly to the farmer. You know who's growing on how much land and who's selling it. And with the satellite imagery data, you have the past 50 years data also, you have the weather advisory going forward also. A farmer can come to know, or a banker can come to know, that out of last 5-10 years, in how many years the farmer has been able to successfully grow crop in his land, whether it was affected by drought or flood in any year. It's all there, satellite imagery data, but it's not available that quickly by just entering his Khata Khasra number. You mentioned CIBIL for farming. I think that's already there. We require a SARSAI for farming, which has all the history. And this quick, which Samir touched upon, quickly we should be able to create charge and release charge. That's already happening. I hope this happens soon. And I know many players are already working on it. Now coming to equipment financing, why it is not taking up? Because A, we already heard much about it. I'll not repeat those arguments. Why the term financing is not happening? Why the capital formation is not happening in agriculture? Equipments are basically higher in cost. They take longer capital investment from farmer side, and their benefits are also accrued over a period of time. Right now, the financiers are more interested in working capital nature of financing or short term, where their money comes back quickly, and rightly so. They are dealing in public money. Even NBFCs are borrowing from banks and competing with banks, so they're also dealing in public money. So the equity capital that needs to go to farmer is not, the lenders don't have the risk appetite to fund that long-term investment right now. What government probably should do is, one, maybe the uniformity of price. Private sector mostly in India doesn't need subsidies or SOPs or any kind of support from government. What basically we need, if you look at all the success stories in India, whether it is software industry or all the other big success stories in our 75 years of independence, most of them have happened despite government. So government rather should take the hindrances or the law which is hindering that growth. For example, drone, usage of drone in agriculture, it's a revolutionary technology. I've seen this in last 2 months, farmers basically doing a trial on their farm with drone spray, and they did it to save because they didn't have the labor to spray. They had no other option but to go for drone. But when they went for it, they realized the other advantages. Better land utilization, you don't have to leave spacing and all for tractor to move and for other labor to move. The damage to crop is minimal, the uniform spread, the time taken, tractor takes 1 hour, drone takes 10 minutes, those kind of advantages. Farmers are very savvy, very value conscious. So if they're able to witness this on their own, they will go for it with or without any support. And the private sector is also ready to cater to that demand with or without any support. But the law doesn't allow, you know, for safety reasons and for valid reasons, the usage of drone is not that freely allowed because it can be misused and there can be issues. So if the government can address these hindrances in tech adoption in by farmers or by institutional lenders or by equipment manufacturers, that will be the greater a greater service to this sector, which will lead to more mechanization. If they want to support, they can maybe uniform the prices like they've done for micro irrigation systems. Pan-India, the government fixes the prices. If you look at other equipments, the variation state to state can be anywhere between 25 to 50% state to state. So there is no uniform pricing. There is no service mechanism available. The manufacturer basically leaves it to dealer to service the customer once the sale has happened. And the dealer is not interested. Dealer is maybe looking at new farmers for selling his produce because that's where he gets the commission. So if government can push it on the equipment manufacturers that you have to service, and that also can be covered under that unified farmer services interface. You know what the farmer has bought from whom, and he's responsible to service it maybe once a year or as the frequency is required. So those kind of prudent initiatives are required if this mechanization has to happen. Even if all of this doesn't happen, the mechanization is still going to happen despite all these interventions and despite no SOP from government. But this trend that was there even before COVID, farm mechanization was progressing. COVID has accelerated this trend because of the migration. The agricultural labor is not there. Most of them belong to eastern part of India and they are working in western part of India in states like Punjab, Gujarat, Maharashtra, Tamil Nadu. They've gone back. So there's a labor shortage. Some of them may come back, some of them may not come back. So this mechanization will happen. The pace can be decided by government if they choose to remove the hindrances and give some policy support to this sector.
True, agreed. Mayank, I'll come to you directly now on, you deal with farmers, you take the produce, right? So how crop and other farm sector insurances can play a significant role in mitigating the systemic risk? Because as we all know that, farmers or at times you don't know how the crop is going to turn out at the end of the day when the produce cycle comes in. And how insurance works as an enabler for financial institutions for lending long-term finance to the farm sector. If you can take everybody through that.
We don't directly deal with insurance as a product, but my view on the whole topic of insurance is that yes, it could actually prove to be a game changer, right? I mean, there was, and it's a relatively new concept anyway you look. I mean, it's not just that we don't have it in India, and it's a very prevalent concept in Western economies where farming in general is far more developed than ours is. There was an example of a company, I can't recall the name, the company is only about 10 years old. And it initially started as an insurance sales company. But the way they went about it, I mean, the biggest challenge, and I sort of tell this story because we are likely to run into a similar challenge here in this country, is that their biggest challenge was actually convincing the farmer to buy the insurance. But they were actually able to do it on the back of data, decades and decades of data, which was collected by the US government. And they were able to show that, look, in this particular year, this is what the rainfall pattern was like. This is what other climatic patterns were like. And this is the produce that you had against what you expected. And if you had bought insurance for XYZ amount, this is how much money you would have made. And on the basis of that data, they would actually prove to farmers that insurance is something that made a lot of sense for them to buy. Given the lack of any such information here, I think just selling the concept of insurance itself is going to be challenging. I don't think anybody disputes the utility of an insurance product. Even from an insurer's perspective, pricing the product itself is a challenge unless you have the data to prove how it should be priced. You know, we've got a lot of bankers on the panel, and they will all tell us that any product that you sell is priced to a great extent based on historical information, on the basis of performance of similar products in the past, and so on and so forth. But that unfortunately remains a big challenge for us. So while it's a great product, I think the implementation is going to be very, very challenging.
True. And what do you think?
I have 2-3 points here to add for this insurance. May I?
Yeah, sure.
Crop insurance is a fantastic product, as you know, said by Mayank also. Only thing that, government has also come out with a fantastic policy. But you look at what is the policy. Policy says, it is not covering the loan. So that insurance coverage is not for the loan. It is for a particular amount. That is what we say, sum insured, right? Now that sum insured is defined by the insurance company on basis of the data which they have, which generally is 10 to 15% maximum of the loan outstanding, right? So that's the impact which is crop loan has over a farmer loan in case of a calamity or a default by the farmer for the reasons which are beyond control, for which insurance company has thought that they should compensate him, right? So here I think that it should be to the extent of the loan, and, you know, they define, of course, you know, we cannot give 5 crore rupee loan in 1 acre of a land, but this should be defined, not as per the, you know, indicators, weather station indicators and the loss estimation, which they do through multiple methods and leave it to the insurance company to decide. So in my, and secondly, claim settlement ratio, even in, I can tell you from my own experience, in last 4 years of a time, if I had given them a, you know, premium of 400 crore, my total claim received would be around, you know, 500 crore. So it's against the 400 crore, 500 crores of a settlement, which has happened. Now, I don't think that's a realistic scenario. Somewhere we need to look into it and, you know, try and see that, you know, we should make it a little more, while affordability has been taken care by the government by paying a lot of, you know, subvention to it and by, you know, but end result would be achieved if, you know, this thing is again, you know, can be left to the bank to the extent of, you know, skill of finance. Maybe you can decide that, you know, what is the outstanding of the loan per acre, maybe a scale of finance, but then that whole amount should be reimbursed or, you know, compensated by the insurance company, not the basis of, you know, whatever their loss assessment. And secondly, ratio against, you know, settlement ratio has to go up multifolds, and it should be on the time-bound manner. That is 2-3 things which I think should be there for the crop insurance to be successfully, you know, getting the end result. Otherwise, it is kind of, you know, support system, but I don't look at it as from the very good, you know, credit risk mitigation, because it is only 5-10%.
If I may add to that, Samir, you're absolutely right. I mean, you talked about the amount of claims versus the premium received. I mean, that's the point I was making about pricing, right? But then the next question is, at what point does that pricing become so prohibitively high that nobody is going to buy it? And I think that's where a lot of political will is acquired, where the government simply steps in and says, we are the ones who are going to absorb this cost. Otherwise, just like a lot of other schemes which have been floated for farmers, this one is going to meet a dead end. So you know, proper pricing and government intervention, I think those two things are going to be key.
Precisely. Sure. Correct.
Sure. Mr. Nath, let me just bring you in here. I wanted to understand, because you're building a book which is very dedicated to the SME space, how can innovative financial instruments, and what are the kind of instruments that you are using, you know, to bring in more customers?
Yeah, so you're right. And as I said that, you know, we are a deeply sector specialized lending institution driven by knowledge and technology. Food processing is a sector which we operate, which is, you know, up of the value chain of the farmer itself. One of the trends which we are seeing and what we think, so we say that, you know, SME financing in India is at an inflection point where it will become equal to consumer financing. What I mean to say, what we call collateral to cash flow. Because historically, and something similar is the problem for farmers as a segment, lending institutions, when they used 5 years back, when they used to go to an SME borrower, they could neither assess his you know, revenue potential or revenue capacity, nor his expenses, nor the margin. And they ended up asking only for a collateral to lend to an SME. That is changing because of the digitization, which is happening in the economy, you know, post GST and banking and, you know, bureau coming in for SMEs. So this tripod of the data is now allowing us to look beyond what is reported financial of an SME, or look at more what is his actual in potential to pay back in shorter tenor duration. And that is transformative when it comes to the SME financing. And the instrument of this is what we call, you know, entity level financing to a cash flow based financing, wherein more and more we are not financing the business, we are financing the transaction. And that is making sure that we have the comfort that, you know, when a transaction happens, the cash flow attached to the transaction come back to us. So I'll give you an example, and that's why I alluded that how digital marketplaces can dramatically change the credit dispensation. So when government launched what is called GEM, which is government e-marketplace, which is equivalent to an Amazon or a Flipkart, it has now 130,000 crore of public sector procurement happening. 50% of that is happening through MSME. We, along with iSpirit, actually, you know, did the entire GEM Sahai financing platform. It is hosted now with Ugro, and our rule engine runs on that. What we were able to solve a problem that when an Indian Railways, for example, giving an order to a small business, for procuring a stationery for 5 lakh rupees. Now the business needs at least 3 lakh rupees of working capital. If you go and try financing, or if the SME try taking financing from a bank, his time to deliver the order is 15 days, but the financing would come in 3 months time. But because most of the lender would worry about whether the SME would be able to, you know, deliver in time, whether Indian Railways would pay him in time or not, and that's why lending was not available. But the same thing happening on the platform, and when you look at his track record and the rating on the GeM platform, when you pull his GST plus banking, and Indian Railways giving 75% of the money in an escrow account, you are financing that purchase order. Today, if order is getting discounted or financed in 30 seconds to 1.5 minutes, and it takes roughly around half an hour to money to get disbursed to a small business. And that is transformative. And think of this, is that government had a digital e-marketplace, which is a procurement engine, and wherein on one side, everyone who procures, you know, goods, farm sector goods, and there is, you know, logistic attached to that, and farmers can sell on that. Every lender would be able to then create credit platform around that. So that is one. As long as there is an instrument or a methodology to finance particular sale purchase transaction, so it's like a purchase order for an SME, it's a crop, a seed input credit given for seeds for a farmer, and the produce being going to a platform, and that platform is financing that. Second, as I think so, which all Samir also said, that, you know, we have to believe that as SME as a sector is important, and there is a lot of support is there. If you look at the historical trend of loss ratios, which either SME as a sector or agriculture as a sector create, and except that the advantage governments have that SME as a sector is the revenue contributor to the government through GST and also through, you know, income tax, versus agriculture doesn't do that. But the value chain actually also provides revenue to the government. So if like you have CGTMSME, which is credit guarantee scheme for SME as a sector, if there is a budgetary allocation for a massive, you know, farm credit guarantee scheme, Assam government has one such a scheme. But if you have a national credit guarantee scheme, which allows the lender to not then look at every, you know, small unit of a farmer and his ability to pay, but it is done on the gross basis that if 100 farmers and if 15-20% of that, even at default, governments are not out of money because of the incremental revenue. But that kind of a guarantee scheme would make sure that the liquidity available within the banking and financial institution system would dramatically start going in real way. And over a period of time, this can be paid. In some way, it is happening, but it is happening on a post facto basis. We have farmers waivers happening. We have other things are happening. There's so much of things which happen that is post credit basis. But you can do it on a pre-credit basis, and then the credit dissemination will start becoming very, very large. So I think these are two things. Some form of any reformative change in any country, while a private sector can contribute, but finally the policy maker, the executive has to take that call, right? Because they have the balance sheet and sovereign power. So any reform or a revolution would happen from there. And then private sector has to, you know, use that for their, you know, make sure that they make it fully viable. So I think so we have to eventually, political dispensation have to rise above their immediate interest, and, you know, let this whole, you know, debottlenecking happening. Farm sector reform bill was one such initiative. It has to say light of the day. Farmers' ability to go directly to the consumer through digital platform can be very transformative, and that would, you know, make credit available to farmer. And if that supplemented with a massive guarantee scheme, I can guarantee you that, you know, India as a agrarian economy would start flourishing again big time. So the second green revolution can happen by, you know, force of capital and credit through this mechanism.
Sure. I'll go to Mr. Charyalu, because, you know, you're part of the largest bank in India. If you could just talk about the kind of financial instruments like guarantee-backed loan, etc., that the financial institutions are using, or are you using new products to get more people on board?
I think this partly has already been discussed, in the sense that you know, there is only so much we can do in agricultural lending. Right? In the very beginning, it was discussed either there is a short-term loan or there is a long-term loan.
Sure.
And whatever packaging we do, like, you know, one product which I can say is that, you know, asset-backed lending, which is available to individuals and which is available to entities, we started giving an asset-backed lending product to farmers also. And similarly, warehouse financing, we started doing where a farmer can, instead of selling the goods immediately, store them in a warehouse and you know, draw finance against the warehouse receipt. But these are all small initiatives, but as other panelists have rightly pointed out, I think the future for any new products will you know, depend on debottlenecking. I really like this phrase, debottlenecking the entire ecosystem, where the farmers are permitted to sell to whomever they want to sell, wherever they want to sell, at whatever is the realizable price, without the grip of market yards or without the grip of middlemen. And at the same time, integrating that kind of information with the other pieces of information so that the rule engines or the digital technologies can make credit decisions faster and cheaper. I think I really like that you know, point that if we enable these two and then coupled with the credit guarantee scheme. In fact, that's a very interesting thing. I did not bring it out in the right in the beginning. If you see, all the incentives are given only to short-term financing. The long-term financing, there is no incentive at all. There is no prompt repayment incentive. There is no intervention, subvention, or there is no crop loan insurance or crop insurance. So I think it's not the dearth of products per se. It's the dearth of the interconnections between various pieces, which is hurting the flow of funds to the farmers. You know, and then already, if you look at, we are actually financing the transaction for farmers. When you look at the crop loan, it is one transaction we are financing. So there is nothing much more we can do to break it down to further. So I think more than new products or new fancy products, I think the interconnection between various pieces and enabling provisions, that is more important. That is my view. I think others can please chip in.
I have a view here. Pooja, can I say?
Yeah, sure. Please do.
Or I'm consuming a lot of time.
No. Please do.
So see, I tell you what. First of all, we should understand how we look at a farmer. Like Pooja, you are working. When you go to a bank, you can ask for any loan, right? Nobody says that, you know, there is employee loan, right? Correct. You can ask for, as I have said in the beginning of the conversation also, this discussion, that, you know, there is a education loan, there is a you know, a personal loan, there is a credit card, there is, you know, housing loan, there are any damn loan in the whole world is available to you. But when we talk about farmer, somehow we, you know, think that it's only a crop loan which is required, and there is no other loan which is available to the farmer, as I say, in the industry right now also, which is linked to his cash flows. 6 महीने का और 12 महीने का और 3 महीने की जो फसल होती है उस पर जो कैश फ्लोज आते हैं, ऐसा कोई प्रोडक्ट नहीं इंडस्ट्री में, कोई ने बनाया नहीं है. तो इसका मतलब उस पर सिर्फ फार्म लोन है. मेरे हिसाब से सारे लोन उनको दिए जा सकते हैं. ऑल दीज लोन कैन बी एक्सटेंडेड टू देम. यू कैन कस्टमाइज इट टू देम एज पर देयर कैश फ्लोज, एंड यू नो दैट विल हेल्प इन, यू नो, seeing that, you know, crop loan defaults will come down because there will be a proper end use and it will be monitored appropriately. That is point number one. Point number two, there are, you know, the moment you do something of this sort, you should also look at it from the point of view of, you know, what should be the future of even the crop loans. Not only, you know, these additional loans which I'm talking about, the, according to me, he's a consumer, he should be given all consumer loans, and one should know that how to assess them and as per their cash flows. Now, I think I see a lot of potential in LAP, loan against property. Now, what is the property of the farmer? His farmland, right? Now, today, we are only be able to give him a scale of finance, which is decided by DLTC, which is 30,000 rupees for paddy, 20,000 rupees for wheat per acre, and per acre land in Punjab is almost a crore. तो कोई आदमी अपनी 1 करोड़ रुपए की जमीन आपको देके 1 लाख रुपए का लोन लेने आता है और आप उसको 5 तरीके से असेस करते हो और उसको 1.5 लाख रुपए दे देते हो. दैट्स इट. आप अपना कोई घर गिरवी रखने जाओगे. मैं इफ आई लिव इन लेट्स से इन मुंबई एंड इफ आई गो एंड पुट माय 2 BHK फॉर लोन अगेंस्ट प्रॉपर्टी, समबडी सेज एंड समीर आई विल गिव यू आपके 4 करोड़ रुपए के घर के लिए मैं आपको 2 लाख रुपए दूंगा, इट्स इंसल्ट. Forget about anything else, right? So I think that, you know, we should look at it from a multiple point of view. We should not only look at it from the point of view of crop loan. We should start looking at farmer as a one person who is a consumer and who is, and any farmer who has the ability to pay you, भले ही उसने अपने farmland पे पीछे एक छोटी सी दुकान खोल रखी हो या कोई beer bar and restaurant बना रखा हो, if he has an ability to pay you, you should be able to lend him, and that's where, you know, I think there is a lot of opportunity and skill.
True. I was just going to come to you with the question that, you know, what are the incentives that you think are required to augment the allied sectors? I mean, what do you think? I mean, apart from just the farm loan, the other sectors that are around it, how do you see loan growth happening on those segments?
You're asking me, Pooja?
Yeah.
So, see, horticulture, allied, of course, you know, all food processing industry. Let me just talk about the primary industry, which is agri and allied horticulture and others. They are growing faster than most of the cereal, pulses and other, you know, crops. They are actually 30% growing, while remainings are, you know, within 5 to 6%, and that too from the value point of view, because they are inflation adjusted, these numbers. So if you ask me, those are actually not growing, while, you know, we have a lot of growth which is happening in agri and allied and horticulture. Now, only the biggest challenge for anybody to be able to do a large-scale horticulture or agri and allied is to have a market nearby, right? Horticulture is something like, you know, if you grow apples in Kashmir, by the time you take them down to Kerala, you have, you know, 2 days of a time or 3 days of a time. So, you know, price discovery mechanism, as you know, other panelists have also pointed out, is something which we need to see. So we need a large scale agri infrastructure and logistics. While government has announced an outflow of around, you know, 2 lakh crore and over a period of next 3-4 years, and it will take some time, but I am seeing that it's a good future coming in if we can create something like this, like, you know, cold value chain, eastern west freight corridor, localized infrastructure. And in fact, you know, I am seeing a lot of, you know, momentum happening in agri infrastructure area, but then it is still a, you know, work in progress. It's a long way to go in such a large country. Unless that is done, I don't see too much of a, because there is no market. Let's say if today I decide to do pineapple as a farmer, where will I sell? Do I have a ways and means to sell? Mere paas jo market hai bagal mein, wahan pe to sirf wo log tomato khareedte, wahan pe wo sirf aloo khareedte, और वो वहां पे सिर्फ वीट खरीदते हैं. तो मैं पाइनएप्पल उगा के करूंगा भी क्या? इवन इफ यू नो माय क्लाइमेटिक कंडीशन आर सपोर्टिंग मी एंड आई नो दैट यू नो आई विल मेक अ लॉट ऑफ आई पुट एन एग्जांपल आल्सो कट द लॉन्ग स्टोरी शॉर्ट. केरला में व्हेन आई वेंट देयर आई हैव सीन अ लॉट ऑफ माय फार्मर्स हु आर डूइंग रबर एंड आई फंडेड अ लॉट ऑफ रबर फार्मर्स देयर एंड दे आर डूइंग फेयरली वेल एंड सम ऑफ देम आर नॉट डूइंग एट ऑल व्हेन देयर वाज अ यू नो प्रॉब्लम इन द रबर सप्लाईज ड्यूरिंग दिस स्ट्राइक ऑफ द टायर इंडस्ट्री. When I went there, I checked, I realized that, you know, some farmers are paying and some of them are not paying. Jo farmer pay kar rahe the, wo sare ke sare wo the jo rubber ke jhaad ke niche pineapple ugate the. Pineapple ka jo jhaad hota hai, it's only 4 and 5 feet, right? And rubber is like around 20 to 30 feet. Wo uske niche sabse acha ugta hai. To unke paas pineapple ke 8 lakh rupaye ke cash flows the. Jin log nahi uga rahe the niche, uske wo bichare rubber ki wajah se phas gaye. So, you know, it's all about, you know, market. अब जो नहीं उगा रहे थे उनसे पूछा तो बोला कि भैया हमारे से तो खरीदने नहीं आता, जिससे हम पैसे लेते हैं करते हैं या जो मार्केट है वो हमारे से लेने ही नहीं आता. इस एरिया में हमारे कोई पाइनएप्पल का मार्केट ही नहीं है. इवन इफ आई टेक अ लोन फ्रॉम यू एंड यू नो स्टार्ट कल्टीवेटिंग पाइनएप्पल, आई विल नॉट बी एबल टू गेट द मार्केट, आई डोंट हैव टाइम. सो दीज आर द प्रॉब्लम्स. आई थिंक इफ वी फिक्स अप दीज थिंग्स, देयर इज अ ह्यूज पोटेंशियल. पोटेंशियल मीन्स इमेंस. I mean, next 4 years would be, you know, kind of a miraculous history for the country if in case we can create this infrastructure in around. And I think that's the biggest requirement.
True. I'll take it to Mayank quickly. What are the incentives do you think are required to augment the allied sectors to develop infra associated with, you know, the warehousing, logistics, and supply chain management for farm produce?
Sure. So once again, Pooja, I think this is an area where we need to take a slighter, longer term view. You know, we as a country, again, we store most of our grain today in warehouses, right? That's one issue to begin with. In warehouses, we store it in jute bags. And whereas most of the developed economies have moved towards bulk storage. The second issue is that in India, you don't find a lot of fungibility in commodity, which essentially means that if I have somebody who comes and deposits commodity in a warehouse, when they come back to collect it, they will say, I want the same exact 100 bags back that I deposited with you. So the question is not that I deposited 100 tons with you, give me 100 tons back. And both of these issues essentially continue to propagate, what you might call outdated storage practices. So over a period of time, I think we have to move towards bulk storage, which essentially means silos, bunkers, what have you. I mean, there are multiple types of technologies there. In the long run, not only is it safer to store that way, it's actually, scientifically speaking, it's actually much safer as well. From a preservation perspective, because there are better ways to control the quality of the crop that you're storing. But the lack of fungibility, unfortunately, holds us back. Once again, this is an area where we've seen some movement in the last few years, but the movement has essentially only come from two areas. One is either the government has been building silos, because the government purchases agri commodities in large quantities, so have the ability to store it in bulk. And the other participant in this have been companies which are large enough to build their own silo capacity. But again, in the grand scheme of things, that's fairly limited, right? I mean, they may set it up for one plant or another, but it's not as if they're setting up facilities across the country. But to encourage this at a larger scale, I think there needs to be, once again, the government has to encourage that, even in the private sector. Setting up these facilities is not cheap. As compared to warehouses, I think the upfront cash flow is a lot higher. But in the long run, I think they turn out to be cheaper. So some government intervention would be required there as well. But I think that's definitely the way the future should look like.
True. I'll now throw this open to all the panelists. I would like all of you to chip in at the, their last two questions of the panel now. First one would be, what do you think, how can we channelize long-term capital? I mean, again, coming back to the same question, I know we're repeating it again, but what is really the ways that you think the ways to channelize long-term capital to agricultural production or for enhancement of agri yield in the coming times? And do you really see a way there could be a pickup in the long-term financing from institutional lenders in this space? Do you genuinely see a way out?
I can take it up first. Yeah, I think so. The way we are attacking this and we are thinking, as I said, giving credit directly to a farmer for a new generation entity becomes very, very difficult, because the kind of physical reach and understanding of farming as a sector required. The way we think about is to be in the every value chain, which is attached to the farm sector or an agricultural sector, food processing, which has multiple components of that. And actually, if you enable credit for people who are, who are either producer, value adders, or who are procuring goods and goods from agriculture as a sector, in fact, that credit availability to them also make credit available to the farmers. As Ravi was saying, that one of farmers today are limited by the informal credit being provided by the local traders, who actually lock them of what they want to do, and that's why his ability to go to a newer set of things is very, very complex. But as long as at least the financial institutions at the first level start enabling credit to the value chain, the same would get translated back to the farmers itself. So I think so that is where our focus have been, without going all the way to the farmer itself. And that's where a lot of many experiment instrumentality can be created. And a little bit of repetition, I think so it's time has come wherein rather than doing bits and pieces, there is some form of, sovereign or government support for the sector has to come, which makes sure that the large portion of, just having a priority sector target, I'm believing that the priority sector target itself would make sure that the credit would start, happening at the ground is little far-fetched. But it has to make commercial sense, and it has to be done in a way. And one way of that is providing credit support to the sector itself. That's what we are doing, and that's what we are hoping for that to happen over a period of time.
Okay.
I think Pooja, like Ms. Nath also mentioned, and we've been discussing, I think all panelists touched upon that. More and more, we digitize these value chains, and we have this technology, this transaction cash flow data available. What has happened in SMEs already? Because of the GST and e-way bills and all these, they have to file income tax returns and all. They have some documented income and documented cash flows that is missing in agriculture. So this digitization and removal of hindrances, like we use the word de-bottlenecking, the laws that are hindering. For example, I keep saying this on various forums, there's a lack of level playing field between financiers themselves. A public sector banks, a private sector bank, and an NBFC are not equal in eyes of the regulator or in the eyes of government. And this is maybe not deliberate, but because of the policies or the laws that have been framed, they are hindering the flow of credit to agriculture. A farmer today, if he decides to buy a micro irrigation system, for example, and he takes a loan from a specific or 16 specific public sector banks, he's getting subsidy. But if he takes that loan from a private sector banks in some states or in NBFCs, from NBFCs in most states, he's not getting that subsidy. So this lack of level playing field, this differentiation in policy has to be removed so that more credit flows to the sector. Mr. Charalu mentioned that there are a lot of incentives to short-term credit, but there are no incentives for long-term credit. I think for most lenders, there are disincentives for long-term credit. There is no guarantee support available. There is no subsidy support available for most products. And I'm not talking about agriculture alone. Most of the allied sectors also, like dairy, poultry, they are all also feeling this pinch of lack of labor and lack of specialized, manpower to handle the cattle or the livestock that they have. And there are equipments available. But there is no uniformity in pricing. There is no uniformity in quality. There is no subsidy support available mostly. And the credit flow to those sectors is basically hindered by policymakers themselves. So, and these are small anomalies. It's not very difficult challenge to solve. It's only a matter of, I think, on whether it is digitization or removal of these archaic laws or archaic regulations. It's a matter of will. Somebody needs to sit and decide that we want to ensure the flow of long-term credit to agriculture and allied industry, and it should happen. The initiatives like Unified Farmer Service Interface may take time because of the nature of the complexity involved, but many policy initiatives are easy to do. Even on post-harvest financing, like Mayank pointed out, anybody in my knowledge who has invested in these silos and all is not making money. Their infrastructure is there and they are basically finding ways to utilize it somehow to make it profitable. So there has to be a coherent policy design. We hear about countries where the government tells certain farmers to grow something and certain farmers not to grow something, so that there is no glut of one commodity and a shortage of another commodity. When this digitization, this unified farmer database is built, probably that will become possible in India also, where the policymakers or the decision makers can guide the farmers that I'll give you certain extra incentive if you grow this crop. And I'll provide a market for that, like Sameer mentioned, there has to be assured offtake of that commodity. That kind of agriculture guided policy decisions are possible only once we have this database in place and all the pieces of this jigsaw puzzle are falling in place. I think that is the need of the hour.
I want to add on a few points. I mean, I would not touch upon the points I think are already covered by all esteemed panelists. There is two, three things. If you try and, you know, increase the capital formation and investment credit, there are two things. One thing is like, so one customer driven, another one is bank driven. Now, customer driven means there should be a pull. Like customer would want, a farmer would want, you know, I would want to put up a drip irrigation, I would want to put up a solar pump, I would want to put up, you know, these things. So these things are basically a lot depend on the government interventions, exposure, training, requirement, market, availability and all those things. So bank or a financial institution will have a limited role to play, but yes, they will, they can. But as far as push is concerned, like bank would do it only when they get, see today, when you go to DLTC meeting with the collector or SLVC meeting, what is that you are being reviewed for? You are reviewed for the crop loan, right? There are crop loan targets which are given to the bank at the district level, committee, technical committee level, at the state level, bankers committee, and even for the larger thing in your crop loan target, which you submit to the regulators also. That is one. Second thing, while I'm not talking about the interest subvention subsidies, which are not given by given to long-term investments, but also the most important point, if you look at for the term loan point of view here, why should I not be given if, let's say, today I am considered as A against a PSL target, while term loans are considered against only agri target, not against crop loan targets. There are multiple targets within the PSL target and agri targets. It's a very technical, but I would want to put it because it's a very important thing. Now, if term loan are given double the weightage of the agri achievement, like we have started doing for certain, you know, food processing centers, whereby if you do, you will be given a 2x PSL benefit. Something like this comes up, if you do a term loan, a long-term investment credit, you will be given 2x benefit in terms of PSL achievement. I'm sure banks and financial institutions will be motivated to do it more. Today, if they do a term loan vis-a-vis a crop loan, there is a lesser incentive. So I'm saying this from the financial institution point of view. Most of other points in terms of, you know, from the customer level, others have been, you know, already covered. So I'm not repeating them. Okay. Yeah.
Mr. Charulu, if you would like to add on it.
No, I think the difficulty of being the last is that most of the points are already covered. But I know, in fact, it's a beautiful point. I fully agree with that. If the bankers are given a higher weightage, it's already there this time in respect of credit deficient districts. I think there are about 125. Whatever PSL we do, we get a higher weightage. So maybe that's something which can be implemented across the board for term lending or long-term lending. And I think there is a government guidance. It's not a directive, but it's a guidance. I can't. I tried to get it out, but could not get it in time. That government wanted to get back to the status which was obtaining in 2000, like long-term to short-term credit should be 50-50. But I think we all need to understand one thing very clearly, is that the farmer, as we said, is quite intelligent. He is street smart in the sense that because he is living in adversity every day. He is not like MSR Charilu who gets a monthly salary and a car and a driver. So he has to live with the adversity. He has to live with uncertainty. So he knows how to do things. Now look at the crop loan. There is a prompt repayment initiative. There is a 7% cap on the interest rate. And also in various states, there is further subvention also. So in many states, the net cost of crop loan is zero. So it's quite possible that people are actually taking crop loans and they are using it for investment purposes. So I think at some point of time, it has become difficult for us to really understand how much credit is flowing for investment also. There must be some gap existing here also. So I think to that extent, unless we have a large scale integration of all pieces, it will be very difficult to understand these things. So I think prima facie, as you very rightly said, first the revolution happened in the personal segment finances with the credit bureaus coming in. I clearly remember 15 years ago, we just depended on somebody producing the salary slip signed and stamped. There was no way of proving anything or disproving anything. And slowly from there, we got all institutionalized. And then we have it for SME. And yes, going forward, I think it will happen for agri also. though it may take the next 5 years or so, where we will have some kind of unified database, at least for 30, 40, 50% of farmers, where we will be able to get the big picture, as the farmer is a consumer. And just wanted to add here that at least in State Bank of India, some of the long-term finance products are also tuned to the cropping pattern. Like if somebody buys a combined harvester, somebody buys a tractor with a bank loan, the repayments are not monthly, but half yearly or yearly as it is applicable. So this is what I just want to say in conclusion of what I want to say. Over to others if they have something more.
I'll add two specific points, if you allow. I know I haven't spoken, but Mr. Charulu said, we also at NAFA, we are offering term loans with crop-linked repayment, 6 monthly, if he's a paddy wheat kind of farmer or horticulture crop farmer, and annual repayment if he's a sugarcane farmer. So that's not a big problem to solve. I think one good thing that we should recognize, I think nobody spoke about this, is what RBI has done, or the government has done during the pandemic time. They allowed, if a bank is giving loan to an NBFC, which is doing investment credit, term credit, that on bank's balance sheet is counted as a priority sector lending exposure, PSL. On balance sheet lending to NBFC is counted as PSL if they are doing on lending only for investment credit, term credit. I think it should not remain a short-term measure only for boosting liquidity during this pandemic-induced era. It should continue, I think, for a longer period. So like we are talking about creating incentive for banks in terms of PSL credit, this can be another enabler where more investment credit is guided towards the sector.
Okay, I'm sorry, but we have run out of time now. It's already 1:30. It's been 1.5 hours. Thank you so much, everyone, for your time. It was very insightful, and I hope it's been helpful for the people who are watching it today. Thank you so much.